Yeah.
Well, first of all, I just want to thank you for an amazing film. And I think one of the things that struck me the most watching it, the scenes where they were looking back at their original, you know, in the first movie that you shot, looking back at themselves, and I just couldn't help but think what a, I mean, you can't put an adjective to unique, but these people live through something that really no one else can identify with. And your film conveyed that beautifully, so I thank you for that. I think what surprised me, I'm certainly no authority on Germany, but was, and I so much appreciate you driving home this point in the movie, the varying degrees of satisfaction with the outcome of the reunification, because you know, there was some nostalgia for the old days in some of these Germans that we saw in the movie. And I only heard one person talk about the Stasi. It was most of the nostalgia was more about jobs, security. Am I right or wrong about that? What was your impression when you were speaking with these people?
I mean, the way the movie is constructed is, it's not, you know, there isn't one answer. It's like the
sure.
film is in a way a sort of debate.
Absolutely.
And it was deliberately constructed that way, that it's kind of a debate between the people themselves,
mm-hmm.
about that question, really. And there wasn't one response. There was this variety of experience, and people, obviously it depended a lot on how people fared, how people coped. And
absolutely.
Some people coped really well, some people, I mean, the couple who have the travel agency,
mm-hmm.
who are the most surprising in a way, because they were in the party, both of them were in the party,
mm.
and then both of them became the most successful capitalists, you know. But I mean, in a way, that says, it says as much about human beings as it does
yes,
about
it
systems
does.
Of politics. I mean, they were successful in both systems because they knew how to survive, mm-hmm. you know, whereas other people didn't do so well.
No.
Particularly the two women, the friends,
mm-hmm.
you know, the two friends who worked on the crane, they never worked again after that.
Right.
And, yeah, I mean, I think it would be fair to say their lives were ruined.
Yes, and I think that's a beautiful answer, because it what you're saying is that you can't just put the whole story into one box. Like anything else, there were varying responses to this sudden change in their lives.
And then, so
what I'm saying is, as a naive American who only, I mean, I was certainly alive and watching all that on the news every night, you know, that's the enduring image. The joy of the reunification at the wall, and then taking the sledgehammers to it. But that's why I thank you, because you've given us this unbelievable insight.
I mean, I think we did, it is fair to say, I mean, we did set out to tell a different story.
Yes.
I mean, you know, because there were plenty of films about the Euphoria, there were plenty of films about the Stasi, actually. I mean, there are so many films and books and things written about the Stasi, we didn't feel that we kind of needed to do that
mm-hmm.
anymore. I mean, it's in the film, it's there, the whole issue of self-censorship and the way they look back at themselves and say what they could say and what they couldn't say. It's obviously an important part of that experience, but we didn't feel like we wanted to dwell on on that. And also none of them, apart from the woman who talks about the Stasi, she was the only one who had an actual real story about that, you know, because her brother had been taken by the Stasi, and she was obviously very aware of it, which is why she has this, you know, conviction that one of us must have been in the Stasi. She couldn't believe that we were allowed to do what we were allowed to do. But I mean, that's still a very open question in terms of how much we were watched, you know. I mean, we were obviously watched. I mean, of course we were watched. But we were also given a lot of surprising freedom, really. I mean, I think we somehow had been given this golden ticket, you know, that we were considered to be okay. And so once we decided, we told them where we wanted to go, they took us, you know, on the research trip, they took us to various locations, and then we said we were the things that we were interested in. So we were interested in the women's brigade because we just thought that was such an interesting thing. These women crane drivers, we thought was just a fantastic thing to follow up. So we said we want to film that, and we were interested in the cooperative, fishing cooperative. And basically said okay. They just said okay. And they just let us get on with it. I mean, there were certain situations where we had to kind of dodge and weave a little bit, where we'd wanted to film in a supermarket, or no, a department store. And when we got there, we discovered that all the people serving at the counters had been replaced.
Oh, wow.
By party members. And so we just said, well, actually, we're not going to film here after all. And we just left. And, there were other stories like that. But, yeah, I guess we didn't really dwell on that aspect of things, because we felt that story had been told.
Thank you.
Yeah. Did someone just, yeah.
So thank you also for this. I was wondering, did you ever consult the files of the Stasi to see why your project was approved to begin with? I, for one, don't find it all that surprising that you were chosen, given what your collective apparently was and how that, you know, the opportunity to advance the propaganda of the GDR to some extent. But have you had that opportunity to consult
this? We did actually try, and we didn't get very far with it. I mean, it's an incredibly convoluted process. I think one of the members, the guy Rich, who lives in Germany now, I think he managed to get his through, but there was very little on it. We didn't get it would have been Murray and myself probably who were the people who went the first time and then came back, but no, we didn't. But we were quite openly we were socialists, and we weren't out, you know, we didn't go there with the intention of tearing the place apart, you know, and they knew that. So, yeah. I mean, we definitely did have this golden ticket, because when we came to Checkpoint Charlie the first time, we drove through with our van. We were just kind of waved through, you know.
Yeah. I imagine your expectation of how this film would develop was partly formed before you arrived, and then something came out that may have been close to it or wildly different. Could you talk about the way in which your ideas were shaped by the voices you heard and even the editing process?
Are you talking about the second film?
Yes.
Yeah, the film,
yes.
Now. I think we were pretty open-minded, actually, when we went. I think we genuinely just really did want to hear people's stories and what we were surprised by. Well, A, we were so surprised that we found everybody.
Yeah.
We found all the main protagonists, which was very surprising given that the whole idea of being able to leave, you know, everyone wanted to leave, but in fact, they didn't leave. I mean, some of them left and came back, and some of them didn't leave at all. And then also we were just surprised by, like I said before, the openness of the interviews, you know. And I think the idea, the structure of it very much came together in the editing. I mean, I edited it and we did show it as well to them. We went back at a rough cut stage and showed them, you know, more or less what we were going to use of what they'd said. And but this idea of creating the debate, that was kind of came together in the editing of it. And because we were originally going to have a lot more of us in it and kind of telling the story of the filmmakers. And in the end we were thinking that we would have debates about it as well, because we had differences of opinion too, and we had a West German translator on the second film who we had furious arguments with and we thought that it would be an interesting thing to include all of that, but in the end we just thought that the characters themselves had all of that we needed within their own stories, and you know, that was fascinating in itself, was to have them bounce off each other. And there was a very interesting moment actually when we took the film back to Rostock when we showed it, and most of the people in the film came to see it. And the guy who is the Ralph, who is the tax accountant, the one, you know, the couple, who have the travel agency, he said to me afterwards, he said, and earlier on, in fact, he had said, when we showed the rough cut to him, he'd been very, because we were quite worried about how they would react, because in a way, we kind of did set them up a bit.
Yeah.
I mean, you know, like it was quite, we were kind of worried how they would feel about, but they were absolutely fine with it. He said in the earlier time when we went, he said, we've been waiting 25 years for people to come and ask us these questions. And he said, you told our story, not my story. Or he said, you told our story. And when he came out of the final viewing, he said to me, he said, I realized when I saw the film and the way that you put it together, I realized that I am a very small person, and that Sylvia, who's the woman who with the disabled son,
mm-hmm.
he said she is a very great person. And I was really affected by that. And well, I thought that was good enough for me. if it made him sort of think about that. I mean, I find Sylvia is the person that really affects me the most in the whole. It's why I ended with her in a way, because she's such a fascinating person.
Mm-hmm.
And she's in a way completely outside all of the other arguments, you know, that she, her experience and what she says, it's really nothing to do with capitalism or socialism. It's to do with humanity and consumerism and, you know, so.
Although it's nice that she has the last words, as I recall, are in fact an affirmation of the freedom she has because of the West allowing her to keep the child at home. And that's, it's an interesting affirmation of a small community, kind of a hybrid of...
Well, I think it's complex. It's,
yeah.
You know, it's complex, isn't it? That's the thing.
Ellen, could you say a little more about how different generations of Germans have responded to this film? You said a little bit about this at dinner, but I was curious.
Yeah, well, I mean, you know, we've only shown it like three times. I've been at screenings, two in Rostock and one in Hamburg. And the two screenings in Rostock, the one in the afternoon was more of the older people. And then the one in the evening, there were a lot of younger people. And the younger people were very, very interested in the film. And what they said was that they don't get taught this in school. You know, what they said was they felt that their own history had somehow been denied them, you know, that they were quite angry about that. I mean, it's an incredible thing if you think, really, that's, you know, I mean, obviously they talk to their parents, they can talk to their parents, but, you know, that in one generation, people can lose their history, even though the people that have that history are still living. I mean, and that's the power of, well, education, the media. I mean, you know, who tells the history, who tells the story?
Was there a pattern, if any, of who identified or who admired certain people in the film, in the generation, like, did the young people like more the travel agents, or did the older people more admire the?
I don't know. Skipper? I mean, I think there was more this kind of feeling about. You know, they're very unjudgmental. I felt that people were very unjudgmental. That's what was kind of surprising to me, that people didn't polarize like that and kind of point at one lot of people and say, oh, look, they were fakes or whatever, or they... People... Because I think there's a kind of understanding of how people operate and how people are. And someone did say to me that's... I don't know. We have a GDR person in the audience out there. But I don't know. People said that was common in the GDR, that people didn't judge each other. I don't know if that's true. But... one thing that at the end of the screening with the older people, I think it was the final screening, actually we had to actually close the cinema in the end because people just wanted to go on talking. I mean they just wanted to talk and talk and talk and talk, but at the end, you know, like a lot of people had to leave because they had to get buses or whatever, and at the end there were people kind of moved down to the front and they were still talking and still talking. But I did notice that most of the people that were left at the end were women, and they were women kind of in their 50s, and they were just like, I think they were the people who most felt that their story had been told. I mean, obviously it is mainly women in the film, I guess, but they said that this thing about these women who were so strong, you know, this thing about these strong women, the portrayal of that, they felt that was something that hadn't been told, but also was somehow being lost, you know. And I found that really interesting. It was one of the things that we had arguments with our West German translator, who, you know, claimed that there was no such thing as feminism in the GDR.
Yeah, following up on Anthony's question, I was wondering if you could talk a little bit about any interactions that you may have had with the children of the people that you interviewed in this film during the filming, and was there ever any discussion about possibly integrating some of their voices into the film?
Yeah.
Because the children that you do have are voiceless, right? You have a disabled child, and you have the girl that we first meet as a toddler and then see again as a 27-year-old.
We did actually interview her, and unfortunately she didn't say anything very interesting, so we decided not to use it. And we did have an idea to go back and show the film and then record a discussion with young people in general about, you know, and maybe to add that as a kind of, you know, an end piece or something.
Well, I just want to follow up on the question just to point out, I mean, it strikes me that the way that the film is presented and was framed by both Jim and you in the introductory remarks, you know, you both used the phrase the past is a different country, right? So it's framed as very much a film about this break in between the two films. But on the other hand, you know, for all of us, 25 years is a long time in our lifespan, and 25 years ago, you know, those are always going to be very different people. So it's I found it very interesting in some of the monologues that I heard, thinking about, well, is this a person talking who is reflecting on a political social system that no longer exists, or is this just, you know,
someone getting older?
Someone getting older, exactly.
Yeah, and I think that is, I mean, there is truth in that, and actually, I mean, some of the changes that have happened to those people have also happened to, I mean, I know people in the northeast of England who would say a lot of those same things.
Here in Michigan.
Yeah, well, yes, exactly. I mean, that's why I said earlier that I don't think this is just about Germany. It isn't just about Germany. Because, well, I think, I mean, we had that discussion about that when we had lunch the other day, but I feel that this is very relevant, that what the people in this movie talk about is the same. It's maybe more dramatic because it happened to them, you know, in the course of 2 years. But that same thing has been happening in the northeast of England and, as you say, in Michigan, the loss of industry and the sort of the kind of writing out of people's histories, and the forgetting of people's lives and people's identities, and, you know, it maybe has something to do with where we are now in both our countries, you know, with what's happening.
Just a very short question. I want to follow up on the question regarding the children. So there were some families who had children, or all of them. How many of them do actually still live there?
The children?
Yes.
Or the travel agent's daughter lives in Zurich. Do you remember they said she went she went to study in Zurich?
Because usually that is the generation that then leaves. So this generation usually didn't leave, too many of them. It's the following generation that left the country and now has this big youth problem in the end.
Actually, I got the impression that quite a lot of them were still there.
Okay.
Yeah. The fisherman Karl Heinz, his children were still around, and they had grown up. They're not young. I mean, obviously, because he's 80 now, so his children were like in their 50s. So they weren't young. I'm trying to think. Yeah, I don't know the answer to all of the stories there. Sorry, yeah, you had...
Following up on that a little bit, what does the outlook for Rostock in the future look like, especially for those children, with their capability of finding a new industry that was lost?
Well, there are some new industries coming. Wind turbines, actually, was one of the big things they were building in the docks there. The shipbuilding had gone right down to kind of building luxury river cruisers, hugely reduced, and the fishing industry had gone pretty much altogether. But then you have tourism. I mean, tourism has taken the place, certainly in Warnemünde, has taken the place of the fishing industry, but there's a lot of unemployment, you know. There is a lot of unemployment. I mean, I don't know.
Did the community seem a lot weaker, like as a community? Rostock, the city, did it seem a lot weaker the second time you visited?
Well, I think certainly, I mean, certainly in Warnemünde, that kind of sense had really gone. I mean, you know, there was still the old people still kind of got together, but I mean, it's the thing with work. If you don't have work, you don't have a reason for people to get together. And yeah, I mean, I think definitely that's what people were lamenting. But then again, it's like Tobias was saying, I mean, you know, that's also true in a lot of places, that community, I mean, I think we've probably spent most of our lives making films about that, making films about community and then making films about the loss of community. It's a worldwide or certainly a Western phenomenon.
I'm curious about one aspect. There was a scene where the two women are talking about how there were sort of special privileges for party leaders and advantages, and they were the little people as opposed to the big animals.
Yeah.
And I was wondering whether there was any expression of a kind of similar resentment toward a different set of winners in a new economic system. Whether there was a sense that there were special privileges that were enjoyed by the economic winners under the new system at all. I'm thinking about the Michigan question and
yes.
recent events in our own country.
Yes.
And your country.
Well, I mean, are you talking about the people in the film being having resentments against each other, or just in terms
other,
of the sort of the idea of the fat cats kind of
yeah.
yeah. Yeah, I mean, and I mean, I think that was part of the sort of resentment about what happened when West Germany kind of came in and basically acid stripped the place. You know, there was a very, very, very great resentment about that. I mean, the idea, and I kind of slightly, there was this idea about Berlin as well. I mean, you know, that Berlin, you know, that there's that kind of small town thing, isn't there, about that nobody cares about us, you know, that we've been forgotten about kind of thing, which is probably true. But, yeah. I don't know enough about the sort of, I don't really know enough about West Germany to know if there are the same, you know, problems and same political movements. I mean, I think there are, but I don't really know how similar they are to the political movements in Britain and in America. You know.
Well, thank you very much.
Yeah.
This is a beautiful film.
Thank you. Thank you very much.